Barbershop Podcast. One more week alive, one more week bringing you the very best in live music from the blast furnace of music, Hamilton, Ontario. This being episode number 136, 136 consecutive weeks from Boxo Studio. That's a hell of a lot, Ryan Cannon.
Yeah, sure is.
Good on you. And we just passed the one-year Garyversary of Gary Greenland.
Didn't get a mic like we promised.
No, we make a lot of promises. We don't come through like a drunken father who never really tells you he loves you. But that's for
another
day.
We'll see how far we can push it. See it before he snaps. One day he'll snap and just throw shit.
Or he'll bring his own mic in. Yeah, he'll be like Flava Flav with a big-ass mic wrapped around his neck. But it'll be awesome, as it always is. Guys, how you doing? Have a good week, Ryan Cannon.
We had the excellent. Are we keeping it a secret?
No,
we got something cool next week.
Yeah, we got really cool next week.
Yeah, we did Oddfellows Open Stage.
Yeah, Dundas, Ontario.
Yeah, our friend Alec Bromke came down with some super duper cameras.
Yeah, and that's all we can really say about
it. Yeah, that's it. And we recorded the whole thing, and we're going to edit it into a show. And, yeah, there's some funny stuff. There's some cool stuff.
First Not From Boxo Studio Barbershop Podcast.
Yeah. And the sad thing is everybody's going to get to see how shitty this actually looks.
And how if you gave us $25,000, how great
this
show could
look. Maybe somebody
will see
this and say, let's give these guys money.
Let them buy five of those babies.
Yeah.
How great would that be?
Awesome.
We thought about it. We wished it. It's going to happen now. It's going to be great. Every week is great, even with our little crappy $30 cameras. It's the very best to sing on the interweb right now. You got to tell your friends about our Barbershop Podcast. And every week we have great stuff, and we have original music, and this week no different. We have the Castor Troys in the studio tonight. They are hard-driving punk rock. I don't know what you call punk these days other than it's got a certain beaten and attitude and thrust to it, but it's rock and roll. It is crafted by guys who have been in the business for a while. They know what they're doing. They bring an infectious style to it and certainly their own story and music. Guys, welcome to the show. How you guys doing?
Thanks for having us.
First of all, let's be clear. There's nothing cool happening this week.
No.
So let's just get that out there. Second of all, drunken fathers.
story of your life.
It's all of my best songs.
You're giving it back.
Adam Walsh, always good to see you. And
see you too.
Yeah, you're sounding great. People are in for a treat. I heard you in soundcheck, sound great. You brought in Chris Ledois on guitar, and Matt Bowker there on bass, and Nick Fowler on drums. And you guys have been together for, what, going on 6 years now, right?
The band has been alive for about six years. This lineup coming up on 2 years solid.
Well, that's good. Two years. 2 years is a long time in the music business.
God, you're telling me.
For four people together, that's like 18 years in a marriage, I think. You could do the math similar to that.
Yep.
Well, you all kind of came up differently in music. We like getting that kind of backstory. And I think we're going to start with Nick, because he admitted upstairs. He goes, well, I'm the quiet one. And I said, it's not hard in that band. He goes, you noticed that, did you? And I said, well, it's good on you. So instead of having to follow their auspicious stories about music and when they started banging on a pot or picking up a parent's instrument, when did you start as a kid, start liking music and knowing this is something you wanted to pursue?
I was into music very early. I had two older siblings that were in a band when I was a kid. I guess one of my first favorite bands was Alice Cooper. I used to wear that cassette out, you know, and just listen to all kinds of tunes like incessantly as a kid. And I finally got my first kit when I was 12. And just, I grew up in Northern Ontario, so I was isolated, had lots of time to learn the kit.
Did you hound your parents endlessly?
I'm surprised that it took till 12 before I got them.
How long did they have to drive to go pick up a kit?
Yeah. Or the Sears guy did on four different trips.
I'm back in Toronto again.
I wore out a couple of those Sears catalog paper drum kits. Broke them in the first day.
Oh, I was thinking a different part of the catalog.
The underwear section.
Wore out the bronze section.
It was Northern Ontario. Before the internet. There was no internet.
Pages are stuck together again.
Well, now, Matthew, we were having a couple of yucks earlier before the show. Clearly, to survive 2 years together, there has to be like a lot of humor and not taking what you do seriously, but not taking yourselves too seriously, and just relishing the first opportunity for someone to lay themselves open so you can just slaughter them. And that's because it's always 3-on-1 as soon as someone opens up, just a tiny little sliver, right? You know, unless Nick, of course, is on the sidelines, always just waiting to see, you know, where the chips lay, right?
When Nick decides to open his mouth and throw one out, everyone puts it down and goes, "Thank you, Nick. Yeah. That was great. You get a point for that one.
Finish him."
Yeah.
Most excellent. How about you? Were you always like the extroverted kid, and music was a channel to get you out of jail or something like that? Or
yeah, no. I was. You know what? I grew up, my dad always had records around, and I'd go put them on. I had no idea what I was listening to. If everyone remembers what record jackets looked like back in the day, it wasn't like the name was just plastered right on it. So I'd just throw anything on and just start listening. Grew up a lot of Hollies and Beatles, of course, with an English father. Once the mid-80s hit and I was old enough, it was... It was heavy metal all the way. Got into Iron Maiden and just never left there.
That was your first love?
Motley Crue, Iron Maiden were my first two that I ran to. So,
It's interesting. The theatrics of Alice Cooper and Eddie was a big part of, you know, when you like a band like that and you're identifying, for a lot of guys my generation, it was Kiss. You know, that was the person who grabbed the 10-year-old or the 11-year-old, you know. But behind it, there was always some... Even if it's power pop dressed up as something, it was always pretty kick-ass music. So your dad have a wicked record collection, it sounded like.
Oh, it was unbelievable. I keep stealing it from him. I go over every now and then, and he's like, "Yeah, I need these, do you, Pops?" And I take them away and keep collecting them at my house. And my wife and I are figuring out how do we display them properly without literally plastering all the walls with nothing but records. So just grabbing the collection to keep it going. I mean... And the sound of old records too, just the energy and the raw sound that comes out of a record, you just don't find anymore.
Yeah, for sure.
So you throw them on, you have a listen, you're just like, "Wow, man, this for today's standards, it sounds like garbage." But when you listen past it, you grab the raw sense of four guys in a room, someone goes, "Record," and they just play.
Oh, yeah. And I mean, I'm sorry, but if you get a pristine copy of like one of those early Van Halen records and put it on, it's like, that kicks ass. You know? Alabama Clam Hash are in here, and they're like, and I've always had a running battle with Ryan about cassettes and the relevancy of cassettes, and I'm stick with them. And sure enough, the kids have cassette players in their cars now, and bands put out cassettes on demos. So I gave them like some old Who, like it was a soundtrack from Quadrophenia, the stuff that all the R&B stuff on it and weird stuff, and there was some of that early the 80s stuff where it's like, yeah, that was like studio with like, you know, tape and racks of compressors and preamps and the sound, you know, pretty cool in its own
definitely
way.
With my new old car, I wanted to put that CD on tape just so I could listen to it in it.
it's true. All right, Aaron, what are you? What's you have a you seem like you probably come from a musical family where you were allowed to.
Yeah, it was my mom and I against the world, and the record player never stopped.
Yeah,
the world won. Oh,
we had lots of records to the
tons. Throw, I mean, it was all over the place. I listened to all sorts of country, be it Dolly or Hank Williams, to pop like Michael Jackson, of course, Rod Stewart.
And she encouraged you to sing, obviously, right? Because it's tough because when you have a natural ability to, like, I think kids are born just like being funny to be able to sing in key and pitch, but to be able to control your voice. That's a trained thing where you
and
have to
recognize that I have no sense of rhythm whatsoever. Yeah. That was key.
Pretty cool though.
So we keyed in on singing.
Exactly. She masked like everything else. She masked it.
Right. No, it was good. And then onto things like Eddie and the Cruisers, where I would listen to the tape until the tape broke. And it just, any singer that was theatric in a way, be it Freddie Mercury, anyway, I just gravitated towards them always, and lyrics have always been a big part of what draws me in first.
Yeah,
everything else comes second.
Were you like writing very early? Like
always.
Always.
sort of a failed screenwriter.
There's no such thing.
Because it, that's true.
Someone,
because
someone just hasn't
it.
Picked it up yet, or you haven't made it yet. Because the cameras are getting cheap. We just used, what, $4,000 film cameras that are battling $50,000 cameras.
I just recycle the stories into songs that we're singing.
Yeah.
It all comes back.
Yeah,
it's great.
It's they're great, and that's one thing when people talk about your music, they say it's packaged in a way that that people love. And yet it's got a lyrical integrity. That's always a pleasure. And Chris, you know, you were always on the edge of society. I could tell you were probably always the one that was at the, outside the principal's office.
He doesn't like anything.
Actually, he pretty much nailed it.
Yeah. It's like, you know, I've got a problem. What do you got?
I was never the popular kid. I wouldn't say I really grew up in a musical household. I mean, there was music on, but I mean, my parents weren't aficionados or anything. Although they started me on violin when I was four, which I hated at the time, obviously. But you know, I'm thinking, start the kid young. Started guitar when I was 12 and kept playing both of them all through high school. Started bands when I was 14 or 15, something like that, playing punk rock. Matt was talking about my aha moment was The Clash. You know, that was what changed everything for me, right? Yeah. You know, and still is today. I still would say that they're my all-time favorite band ever. Yeah. Probably always will be. I was too young to ever see, I mean, their last shows were 82, I was 7. But I was lucky enough to see Joe Strummer in Montreal before he died, which is awesome. Yeah. Really, really good. that was sort of it. Sorry, my throat's all scratchy. I'm just getting over a cold. No, that would make it feel a lot better.
So when you started playing guitar, it was more out of like you want to just, you know, when did you start playing?
I think I was 12. I actually started on bass and then moved over to guitar. Stuck with that. And then I stopped violin for a few years and then picked it up again when I decided I want to go to music school.
Yeah.
After high school.
Because you're actually, you're quite trained. You're like a blue blood musician. You
know, nobody's ever called me blue blood before. Start voting for Stephen Harper or something. After high school, I mean, there was really no other option than to go to music school because I didn't have anything else. I didn't have grades good enough to really do anything else.
Go to business school.
Get a real job or anything like that. I still don't have. I've never had a real job. Not since summer jobs in high school. Went to music school. I studied composition at Queen's and McGill, and still do that. That's my. No, I don't really have a day job. I've sort of got three night jobs.
An HBO composer?
An HBO composer. Yeah, working with the HBO right now, doing some arrangement stuff for a concert tomorrow night.
Cool.
Which is going to be cool.
Now, that's like when you hear an arrangement, do you necessarily hear instrumentation when you hear an arrangement? Like, or do you say that's interchangeable? I can put that in later. That's what I thought. I go, wow, you know, to be interested in rock and roll and punk, and yet to be able to write for bassoons and double bassoons and French horns.
There are certain things, yes and no. I mean, yeah, a lot of music, sure, you can hear that. But when you hear, I can give you two really obvious examples. If you hear, the first couple notes of Safe European Home by The Clash, right? I don't know if you can hear that in your head. It couldn't be any other way. There's no way about that. Beethoven's Ninth Symphony couldn't be done on anything other than an orchestra. And God knows it's been tried, and it's been shitty every time. You know, I mean, it's kind of got to be that way. But outside of those really obvious examples, no, I mean, there's a ton of stuff. I mean, you know, we do our acoustic set, right? We take a lot of our songs, not all of them, but most of our songs work really well in sort of, I wouldn't call it folk or country, but it's definitely got elements of that. Work really well. I got some new samples a couple years ago, had to try them out. So I took one of our songs, Kingston, which I think we'll hear later tonight, had to test out the brass section. So I had all these French horns and trombones and then some low strings and stuff like that. And I was like, wow, this is awesome. And it really works that way, you know? Yeah. So a lot of stuff, yeah, can
a little
can
trial and error. I've been there as producer, you know, where it's something you're sure is going to be great. And then you hear it, it's like, okay, it was much greater in my mind. But it's cool to have, you know, to run the gamut, let it do that. All right, so we'll get back after we hear a live tune, and we'll hear about how this band came together and the progress from then until now. But we do feature live music. It's what we do. We want to drag you out to the live music venues. They are there. They're all over the place. The closer you get to the center of downtown, of course, the more there are. But they are there in your strip malls and in your coffee shops and places. If you look, put it in that internet thing. It's all over. Look for Live Music Hamilton, Ontario. You'll get links to take you there, and you'll get to see something really great. It'll lighten your dreary week. Going out and see some live music. It's great. We got it right here. We've got some Castor Troys at barbershoppodcast.com.
When I need nowhere, hatred and lies, they spill their share. These eyes have wandered straight from the start. God bless the soul against my broken black heart. I know the depth that can be spanned like the back of my own red hand. Grab what you can, believe one part. God bless the soul and my broken black heart. Broken black heart.
That'd be the Castor Troys right here. Broken Black Heart. It's only about breaking one's black heart. That just is so endearing when you're writing a song, especially kick-ass rock and roll song. Before we go to one of the songs off of your recent CD, Come Hell or High Water, recorded in the hood at Boxcar Studios, tell us who are, like, some of the like, do you listen to other music right now, or are you just like so focused on your own music? Because I've done that. Like when I've been playing in outfits, it like really didn't. Like I'd go out to the scene and check out music, but I wasn't actively listening to anyone else other than what I'm playing. But every once in a while, you hook onto something and go, this band is a band that everyone should hear. Like check out on YouTube anyway.
I think as this lineup came together, one of the bands that really resonated with all of us was the Bronx. Mm. I don't know why, but it was a touchstone for all of us.
Yeah.
The Headstones have always been kind of what brought us together, because that, you know, the driving rock with the storytelling and the fire in their belly kind of thing.
Yep.
That was always awesome. But the Bronx, I don't know, what was it for you that, like, I showed it to you first and it just sparks flew. It was crazy.
You know, if you knew, then it wouldn't be as good,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
it's the fact that you don't know what it is that grabs you that makes you know that, yeah, this is just awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it kind of serves as, a, like you said, a bit of musical Rosetta Stone, where if we're going to start something together, this outfit, this, we all dig it, right? Everyone's like, yeah, I dig that. We can work in that direction. So if there's ever any kind of disagreements in the band, it's like, you know, what would the Bronx do?
Since then, Nick and I have really latched onto Clutch. I mean, that was an old favorite. Yeah. I don't know why it just came back now, and it felt right. There's that blues feel to it, the southern feel to it. Even in blues, the Detroit blues, Earl Burnside's album that came out with John Spencer.
That blew
my mind. Yep. And we had that album kind of come into our...
Yeah, I sent him the link to this. I was like, dude, you got to hear this.
And
I found it accidentally. Darren and I are both John Spencer fans, but then I found this. Earl Burnside, if you know, is an old blues guy. Never really broke big and probably should have. And then just before he died, John Spencer did an album with him. And it was this amazing just blending of sounds. And I sent the link over to Aaron. I was like, dude, you got to listen to this. And he wrote me back, I don't know, a day or so later. And just like, you see his brains exploding all over the place. It was,
It actually influenced how Broken Black Heart, that song,
sounds
now. Yeah,
because you changed it. That's right.
That's right.
See, that is a great thing about music, because everyone sees that as a positive thing. And that's why, like, when I see... especially questionable, you know, copyright cases where it's like, okay, music is really, you know, kind of it's a passed along thing, you know, more so in the blues where it's just everything's an interpretation. Yeah. But, you know, it's like, unless you're ripping someone off out, you know, and there's been more cases of that done right in plain sight where it's like, oh my God, songwriter's getting
busted
screwed.
For it yet.
Oh, are you doing some scooping?
No.
Not us.
I'm sitting up there, Captain, saying nothing.
But you guys,
I've always said I've never actually written an original tune in my life.
Yeah, I guess.
Everything is either deliberately borrowed or like an homage or something like that. You know, like deliberately sort of saying, hey, you know, I took this riff or whatever, or unconsciously stolen. Yeah. And then somebody will play me something. It's like, oh, you ripped that off.
1,000 snippets.
I had no idea.
Yeah.
Guilty as charged, right?
It's in there. Well, you're, like I said, you're all crafty, intelligent guys. And so you did a video. A lot of bands have to do a video. It's a great way to get not only the look and the feel of the band across to people, but in a, you know, in your case, you know, it's, I guess, something you would, had you worked in video before, or was this a first kick at the can?
That was a complete first go of it, and just ideas were running rampant, and we finally came up with one singular idea that we're like, all right, we'll go with this. And of course, the second we start, we realize like this idea doesn't quite work as well.
But
we're like, we'll keep going with it. Just keep going. If we don't tell anyone, they won't know. And it was definitely something that was interesting. Like you really get appreciation. And I go back to like the bands in the 80s, because that's when music videos were big.
Mm-hmm.
You get a huge appreciation for what those guys had to go through.
Oh, yeah.
When we're shooting just a video that we've made ourselves.
With a small camera without a lighting rig.
It was a GoPro, and we had tons of lighting.
GoPro
it was taped to a plastic kid's
beat show. My wife shot it, and she's walking around amongst us, because we found that it was steadier if she put it on something. So originally we had a hammer, and then after two or three takes, her arm was like dead.
So this was shot over a long weekend.
Yeah, it was 3 days. Long weekend. So we went with the plastic shovel that was lighter, and it was just...
It worked great. I mean, it was just, you just get an appreciation for doing it, where you're like, that was awesome, and you go back and you take a look at it, and you go,
oh, that sucked.
All right, everyone, back downstairs, get excited again, take 28, here we go.
We had choreography, so, you know, we tried our hand at that. worked out in some cases. Some cases it didn't work out.
Well, this is what's so great about I love it, the do-it-yourself attitude, and people dive in, you know, and they figure this shit out, and they do it themselves, right. And you know, fantastic. You're gonna check them out right now. The Castor Troys, the title track of their CD, Come Hell or High Water, right here, right now. BarbershopPodcast.com. Chris, I think you could safely tell your wife she did a lovely job. It's a wonderful bit of cinematography. And
she held the hammer like nobody's.
Yes. Next time there is a Hamilton Music Video Awards, you have my vote. I will choose you.
2 points.
Yes. Right there. Swish. As they say, and you'll know because funny enough, you, as getting back to that thing about taking yourself seriously by doing a kick-ass video, you don't take yourselves too seriously because you took a bit of a heater. So the boys were very helpful, though. They were sympathetic. They understand that when you're giving your all, these sort of things happen, right?
There was a lot of support.
There was support
in the room,
and this is what I love. That you know, a lot of times where a lesser person would not care, they were leaping in, literally.
They're the brothers I never had.
Yeah, and then you wonder why, you know. And actually, there's a clip of it. Ryan, are you able to get a hold of that clip?
We're the brothers you've never had, and we've all.
You could locate the clip. Yeah. See if you can find it online. Apparently, there's a follow up. Yeah. To that video. I'm sure everyone would understand that when you are together with a band of brothers, it's really like that.
Kids, don't break from choreography.
It's yes, because choreography is super, super important. We all know that. Castor Troys, you are playing. What's your next gig? People are going to be watching. Are you ready? Yeah. Okay, fire it up. Fire it up, Marky.
Watch this, Lise. You can actually pinpoint the second when his heart rips in half. And now. Aww.
Never get tired of that. The help that is not the kind of help that you're gonna get from.
Let me tell you about dedication.
Yeah.
Oh, that's my a God.
You know, before we go on, you have to understand with that video.
That was day one, wasn't it?
We're all kind of bumming around, and this happens. Aaron falls down, and we're like, "Ah, you're okay. Get up, walk it off. You're fine."
Is Nick dead?
So we all go upstairs and we plug into the computer and we watch the video. Aaron's downstairs and he's like, "Guys, I'm in pain." And we're like, "Yeah, walk it off. You're fine, Nancy."
I believe the word Nancy boy was thrown around a lot.
And from upstairs, just to be Aaron downstairs, I would have loved to have been it, because from upstairs, as we played the video back, all you heard was, "Oh!" entire mood changed after that, being like, "Dude, are you okay? Like, what can we do for you? Yeah. Let's get you a smoothie and put your leg up."
A wax. That's always nice. Appreciate
Chris
it.
Chris rubbed his legs. I mean, it was all good.
That's all it took to get along.
It was all good. And you know what fixes it in the long run? Is live music. We're going to give a shout out to our wonderful, faithful sponsor, and then we're going to go have another live sample of the Castor Troys, tonight's guest. You can get their CD on their website, which is, we will have it on our site, but your website is
thecastortroys.com.
You get it there, and I'll tell you where you can get it. You just pump that information into the internet, and it'll tell you where you can get Castor Troy's music. We got them right here. Get a little shout out to our sponsor at hamiltonartist.ca. Anytime we need something printed on something, we go to hamiltonartist.ca, be it a hat, a banner, a mug, a pen, a pad of paper, magnets. Just, you know, if you can think of it, they've probably got it in stock. They'll put your organization, they'll put your band name on it, they'll put your name on it if you're just a wild egomaniac. They do not care. They treat everyone the same, and that is with care. That's hamiltonartist.ca. You can visit them at 1141 Main Street East. They're at Balmoral. That's just east of the Delta in Hamilton. You reach them at 289-396-1653. That's hamiltonartist.ca. You know, check them out. Check them out online. Check them out in person. Great store. Great people. And great music. Tonight is every Wednesday at barbershoppodcast.com. The Castor Troys are in the studio, and they're having a lot of fun, and so are we. And here they are right now, barbershoppodcast.com.
All right, so the Castor Troys, we are peddlers of true stories and truer fiction. This story happens to be a complete fabrication. It's called The Chase. It's about a low-down scumbag bank robber named Jenny. Starts with Mr. Led Riot on guitar. Wisdom from a cold-out bookie she'd known. Jenny and her crew, they got a punk's too. Knew just when to raid the cash flow. James had brought him down and straight from out of town. Smoky eyes and a cigarette. Would it be a thirst? She's willing it's a first in thieving what she needs and how to get far away. James' pistol whipped clerk. Steel read the car outside. The single that applied. 2 minutes was up and their plan had worked. As Jenny raced along, she set her eyes upon Patron make a move for his piece. The boys put him down with 6 or 7 rounds. Show me a hero, I'll write you a tragedy. She'd have to act and quick. She jammed a 9-2, nearly took his hands off the wheel of the car, wrecked in the worst way. Bag of cash in hand, she stumbled to his van in a red sunset as she aimed. The chase is on again. Runs out of scratch and then so it begins. Another time with another friend.
Crushingly, awesomely, live, right here, Twitch TV, our carrier, every Wednesday night, barbershoppodcast.com, the good stuff. You guys brought some good stuff. You brought some cold beer, and a lot of bands don't do that, and you guys did. Yeah, they don't, you know, and we should make that known that you have to bring, and it should be based on some sort of, you know, thing that logarithm that seems fair, but on the outside really isn't. You know,
I was trying to grab Iron Maiden beer before I came.
Oh, that would have been so cool. No, I was.
They never have it.
We're chasing down a beer sponsorship. I think that they would like, someone would like to have their taps constantly running here at Barbershop Podcast. You know, not that it would lead to any kind of unbetold behavior, shenanigans. Yeah, that get people in trouble.
No, we're not sponsoring,
no.
Whoever it may be.
Yes, so keep it hidden. Yeah, it's like we could be drinking anything. And I've been told I should put it in a mug, and then I'd want to get sponsored by a mug company. You know, it doesn't matter.
Everybody needs more mugs, right?
Yes, everyone needs more mugs. Because eventually you break all your glasses.
No, don't say that. My wife keeps buying mugs. She's watching this, and she knows. Yeah. We had this conversation today. I'm like, why do we have so many? There's only two of us drinking coffee.
a bunch of mugs, a bunch of shenanigans. That sounds like a classic night with the Castor Troys. We got one of them
One of the things that I've always found difficult about this band is our music is serious. Our lyrics tend to be serious. And we have so much fun doing it. So, like, to look at Matt and sort of have us laugh in the middle of a song that's about a girl mowing down two other guys and jabbing a knife into them while they're driving the car, it's kind of a, you know, it doesn't work. But it's too much fun to not.
Yeah,
we,
you know,
we make it happen. I mean,
there's a lot of cool horror movies that has that kind of bent to it now. I think that's almost normal in a lot of circles.
You're never satisfied.
No.
All right, the Castor Troys in here with you, Barbershop Podcast. We're going to play another track off of their CD, Hell or High Water. You can get it at their website, thecastortroys.com. This particular one is called High Stakes, a gambling story. Tell me about High Stakes.
High Stakes is really a rah-rah, let's go get 'em kind of song. It was inspired by, Band of Brothers, really, is kind of what spurred that
cool.
one on.
Yeah.
I love a good war story, and why not write a song to it?
Exactly. Yeah. Not marijuana and porterhouse, but we're talking really good war story. We'd love that around here, too, at barbershoppodcast.com. All right, the Castor Troys, Hell or High Water, the song, High Stakes. Great song indeed. So, Aaron, tell me about, you got another gig going on. As much as you would think that rock and roll should pay, you know, a handsome lifestyle, let alone, you know, just a normal one, we all have to be busy. We have to hustle.
Just got the handsome.
Some of us hustle more or less than others, but we all hustle. Tell me about some of the things you're doing. And
Because I can't have enough, you know, moonlighting careers in my life with this going on. Yeah, the Bulldogs, the Hamilton Bulldogs. I've been with them since
Unfortunately, they've left us now, haven't they?
Is all this... in name, we are still there. We are now an OHL team.
Yes.
I've been with them since they were the AHL team, and Bill Stirrup passed away, the great Hamilton legend, Bill Stirrup. I'd worked my way up through all sorts of hockey, announcing in Junior A, OHL, Hockey Canada, and got to the Bulldogs, got my chance. Been there since, and it's been a fantastic ride. We've seen a lot of close runs to the championship. I haven't won one yet.
Yeah.
I'm not going to win a Calder Cup now because, again, we're the OHL now.
You don't know that, though. You might get picked up by, the Marlies or something like that. And you're going to go on and win one there. But the Hamilton Bulldogs, OHL, there's great hockey in Ontario Hockey League.
Yes.
Fantastic. So tell me about your foray into announcing. And did you have any, a formal education or someone just said, wow, you got a great voice, you should do this?
In co-op in high school. I worked at a cable TV outfit because that was the career path I thought I was going down.
Oh, yeah.
Editing and whatnot. So I had some voice coaching and whatnot and really been kind of doing PA-style announcing since my voice cracked. I'm still waiting for it to crack.
That was three weeks ago.
Would you like fries with that?
I had a girlfriend.
Yeah, it made some money on the side. It was fun to do, and you get the best seats in the house in Hamilton. I'm right in between the penalty boxes. Cool. You can't beat that. You're right.
Fantastic.
In the
middle of it. It's good stuff. All right, so why don't you give us a little sample of that? We're going to do some another live music song here at Barbershop Podcast. It's incredibly, for those of you listening and it sounds like you're out in the back of a room, you can imagine that, really loud rock and roll band's on stage and I'm sitting 3 feet away and they're that loud. But you guys do such a great job in there, Gary and Ryan. I want to thank you so much. And the Bose Corporation for providing noise-canceling headphones. And, of course, the Castor Troys for kicking ass with live music right here, barbershoppodcast.com.
So if we were at First Ontario Center, it would sound a little something like this.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome to Boxo Studio here in the beautiful Gage Park area of Hamilton, Ontario. Please welcome back to the ice, your Castor Troys!
Signed him to a long shot, two-way deal. He waiting to lose more than wanting to win until finally he got the call.
Geek-ass rock and roll, pink style, punk style, right here, barbershoppodcast.com. The Castor Troys, they're in the house, they are rocking it hard. It is a vicious game, they say, about this music world, rock and roll. We do it because we love it, and if you want to go support it, you're doing a good thing, because you're going to feel people who do something because they love it, and there's precious little of that in the world. People are doing things because they have to do it. They're doing things because people tell them, because of some shit's going to happen if they don't do it. But, you know... Well, I got to admit, once in a while I've seen a show where someone didn't want to do it. They've usually been doing it for 40 years and making too much money doing it nowadays. But that's not the case. You go out to a small independent show, you will find somebody who does something because they love doing it, and they have to do it to a certain extent of proficiency, because the club owners will not pay for or put up with garbage. It's gotten a bit bad because the price has got so low that, you know, any half... decent band can't work for that kind of money, and the people that you see probably aren't worth, you know, going out for. But there's a new formula, hopefully in the works somewhere, where music is appreciated and supported. It certainly shouldn't be considered a charity case. I think it should be, if someone's going out to pay exorbitant amounts of money for chicken wings and beer, it's probably more than the big screen that they have at their bar versus the big screen you have at your house. It's probably because there's something really great, like live music going on, and that's why people go out and drop.
Know, whenever we're playing, we play to 20,000 people, even if there's only 8 in the audience. Because those 8 people, they paid to come see a show, so the Castor Troys always give me my show.
And you get that reputation that, you know, a lot of times there's grunts like, well, you do it. You just, I've very rarely seen a prima donna bullshit attitude from anyone who has any kind of music. I don't think you can.
I love being part of this scene. There's very little drama in that way. The Hamilton Burlington scene is just, this is what you get.
Not a lot of patience or time. And I think it's kind of understood that you're not going to get very far if you're, you know, and it's it. You know, I don't want to get. I'm getting old now, so I have to watch myself. That just starts, well, what was my day? And I tells you, it's not like that, because I've done a lot of great bands, all ages, a lot of young guys coming up now. I'm just blowing my mind. I just wish there was more opportunity for more people to get familiar with more great independent music.
Reminding people, when you want to go out and do something, go check out a band you've never seen before.
And don't let that scare you. It's not only the people you've seen, because at one point we didn't know anyone who we like now, right?
Yeah, a quick story on that. We played a show on Friday, and a guy came outside and said, you're in the Castor Troys. I said, yeah. Long of the short of it, he had gone online just to look for local music, saw our name, it grabbed him, looked at our website, liked our stuff, came out to the bar to see us, had no idea who we were.
That's how it's supposed to work on paper, but you wonder sometimes if it
does. But that's the thing, out of the 8 people that were there, only 1 came out because they did that.
Yeah.
So always remember, support your local scene. If you're going out somewhere, go have a beer.
Yeah, and if you had a good time, tell the owner or tell the manager. It's like, I'm glad you have music. Okay, I came out tonight because you had a band.
We were out all last week supporting Burlington Sound of Music this year. Had a club series. We were fortunate enough to play it twice, but... it was from the first Saturday where they had the paid event with Weezer on through when the normal festival, the free festival, started on the Thursday. All the clubs downtown Burlington opened up their doors, and they had 2 bands a night. Yep. And we were out every single night, and it was great to see a bunch of friends, people we haven't seen in a long time. And the city supported it fairly well.
I'm on the a committee for Sound of Music. So, you know, not that I didn't want to give back, but I'm on the committee. I need to go out and support what they're doing. They were trying something new. It's the greatest thing. Let's put the local talent in local bars throughout the week.
Yeah.
And it was phenomenal. Yeah. And to go out, and what people didn't realize is that the director, the president, the past president, you know, the vice president, like all the bigwigs of Sound of Music were all out every night checking out the music.
Yeah.
So.
You never know. You never know. Keep at her. Keep at her.
Yeah.
Right here, the Castor Troys on Barbershop Podcast. We're going to play another tune off your CD, Hell or High Water. I'm telling you, come Hell or High Water. Kingston. Yeah. Is it about the city, the penitentiary?
It's Kingston Penn, all right.
Yeah.
That's a true story.
You got to write a good Kingston Penn story, don't you?
Yeah. It's a friend who was wrong place, wrong time, and forced to kind of make that impossible decision of what to do prior to conviction.
Yeah.
And it was written inside of 5 minutes in a moment. And it's probably the most powerful song for me anyway on the album. And it was a great bookend to the end of that record.
Crazy. Well, you're going to listen to it. You're going to hear it. Hopefully you're going to love it right here, right now. Barbershoppodcast.com. Barbershop Podcast with the Castor Troys. That is Kingston, a place as angry as that music. You guys, like I said, you're pretty light, you know, surprisingly, depending on When you catch it, I guess. But live shows, you guys must dig the kind of energy when you get to play an extended, not kind of broken up like we are tonight, but like start piling them on one after another.
We like taking over a night.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Pete Townsend once said, it's like the bigger you try to say something, the more people turn a deaf ear to it. So you've got to work with power and volume. And I imagine you're all proponents of that.
Definitely.
Well, you're going to play a little acoustic thing that end up the night later on tonight, but we get one more wickedly good taste of the Castor Troys. The way they like to serve it up, hot and electric, right here, Barbershop Podcast.
This next one's a new one, Aaron.
Yeah, it's a brand new song.
It's fresh.
It's not on the album. It's called Dead Man's Whiskey. It's loosely based on life experience my dad went through up in Yukon. Horrendous working conditions, and hey, where better a place to write a story from?
Exactly.
On this day, every year, these memories reappear. Well, I know what was done, taking a life. Can't be undone. Well, I'm drinking whiskey and no, I won't shed a tear. A dead man's whiskey and it tastes better every year. Time in my life when I had to shoot fool for food. Brazen young, unaware, moved out to the Yukon where was hell, but the pay was good. Filling plastic company far north of Dawson City.
What am I doing? That was terrible. We cannot show these lovely people that side.
Wanna go from the chorus?
We're gonna go right from the very top, from where we all come in. One, two, three. Stories in their eyes, animals of men, that's
the code. Oh, a trailer through the air, death from blasting granite beer, lungs on fire, rock dusty hair. Met up with this one guy, stoned and buried in 2 days or maybe three. Drinking a dead man's whiskey, stolen all those years ago. I did what I had to do to stay alive and all I knew. And I feel not far from home.
Castor Troys right here at barbershoppodcast.com, rocking it out. Little something there live. Hot and heavy.
Definitely live.
Definitely live. Hot and heavy. Just the way we like it. You can go check out their music. You can buy this CD, Come Hell or High Water. It is full of kick-ass music. We have all kinds of kick-ass music in Hamilton, Ontario. The Castor Troys are another wonderful layer of it. We're going to play, I believe, track 2 of the CD. I got glasses coming. I haven't
play track 7.
Track 7? We're on track 7. Why don't you just, instead of me squinting, you can tell me what it says.
Out here.
Yeah, on the it's right there on the knot on the wood on the another great
always
track.
On the wood.
You know, we're gonna get it through. We're gonna get it done. Come hell or high water, right here, right now, barbershoppodcast.com.
Never quite heather, are they made it
a magical, mystical, wonderful night with the Castor Troys at Barbershop Podcast. It's been a pleasure, guys. Not only do you play at incredibly high volumes where we've had to let the... We released the hounds on bylaw two different times tonight. They're like, that's too loud. And it's release the hounds. And I'm out of hounds, so we have to go to acoustic. It's just perfect because I think they're out of bylaw officers too.
We do apologize about being too loud. I did see a couple for sale signs outside across the street.
Yeah, I fool them every once in a while with, as Ryan calls it, good vagina music, and we like that. But it's like this is great, and I wouldn't call it cock rock, but it definitely has attitude and volume, and it struts and it stands with one foot on the monitor, and there's no. Didn't need to apologize for that. But you guys are going to lay one down acoustically. What are you going to do for us?
This is off the rails. It's sort of a song about dealing with anxiety when you're dealing with someone with a cheating heart. Cool. And this is the other side of what we do. We try and write everything as if it were a Johnny Cash song to begin with, and then turn it up to 10, and then bring it back down to 5, and maybe enjoy a little riff like this. To confide in. Time for me to get. Time for me to get rolling on. It's over, over. Pack my things and step right out the door. Over, over. I'll speak of you no more. My heart in transit. My minute faster, I dare say. Left it. Pales in comparison, failed communication. Hearing all these tales of infidelity, failed the my naivety, full steam ahead and flying off the rails. My heart in transit, a mile a minute faster.
Castor Troys, right here, off the rails, a Barbershop Podcast. Go check out their CD. Go check them out. We're going to be playing somewhere close to you this summer. Check us out next Wednesday as we unleash a wonderful pre-recorded episode for Canada Day. We ain't going to be here, but what is going to be here is some magic we recorded in Dundas last Wednesday. You're going to want to see it. You're going to want to check it out. You're going to tell your friends about Barbershop Podcast. You're going to be a leader in your community. You're going to say, this is the shit. You're going to go check out great original music. You're going to do good for yourself and do good for others. Keep it strong. Keep it real. Keep it on Barbershop Podcast. See you next week.